Good afternoon, it's time and we have a quorum. I call to order the meeting. Item 1 on the agenda. Information paper issued since the last meeting. The Secretariat has not received any information paper about the wrong information involving the National Anthem, if I may report to you, and I'm sure you're aware of that. The wrong information on the National Anthem on the Google search engine. Our colleagues, are, of course, are very much concerned about that, and we have passed on our views to the administration. And then the Secretary for Justice has applied for an interim injunction to the Court of First Instance on the 5th of June 2023 to prohibit the broadcasting, performing, printing, publishing, selling, offering for sale, distributing, disseminating, displaying, or reproducing in any form the song. So at least the government has taken on board our views and is taking certain action, so it's a good thing. Item 2 on the agenda, date of next meeting and items for discussion. The next meeting will be on the 9th of October, Monday, 2:30 p.m. in the same conference room, that is conference room 3. And we will only take one item at that meeting after discussion with the CDB. That is proposed arrangements for the assignment of the radio spectrum in the 6-7 gigahertz band and spectrum utilization fees related facilitative measure. I wonder if colleagues wish to propose any other items for discussion. If not, then we will go by this agenda. Item 3, digital inclusion. First, I would like to invite the administration to join us. And if members wish to ask questions, please press the request to speak button now. So we'll wait for the administration to join us, and then they will first give us a briefing. Welcome. There are 4 government officials joining us. Ms. Cheryl Chow, Deputy Secretary for Innovation, Technology and Industry. Mr. Tony Wong, Government Chief Information Officer, and 2 other colleagues. And I'll hand over the floor to the administration to take us through the subject of digital inclusion and the latest development. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I will briefly explain to you the work progress on promoting digital inclusion by the government. Now, the elderly group has always been a focus of our promotion effort. We reach out and visit elderly, that's our main strategy, so they will get a chance to use digital and mobile devices, and then they could for their own convenience. And then since 2014, the Office of the Government Chief Information Officer, OGCIO, has launched several rounds of outreach program for the elderly. So we reach out to elderly in the territory, those living in residential care homes, in receiving day care center and home care services and so on, as well as hidden elderly. And so far we expect the program has reached out to 24,000 elderly persons. And since the end of 2021, we have launched a pilot program to set up mobile outreach service stations, so at places frequently visited by the elderly, so that they will learn about some useful mobile apps and also the questions of using smartphone can be answered. We hope to reach out to 20,000 elderly persons. And then there is also an enriched ICT training program for the elderly. This is to provide training courses to elderly with some basic knowledge on digital devices. And also we engaging youth volunteers to promote intergenerational harmony. And then through the Elderly IT Learning Portal. This is a place for elderly to get information on digital skills anytime and anywhere. And so far, there's been 17 million hits and 370,000 visits. And also, there are about 600 government websites and about 80 mobile apps that the government have provided accessibility features because this is an important way of promoting digital inclusion. And so we have design competition, and also there are appreciation schemes for accessible apps and websites and so on. And then we also have guidelines to facilitate the elderly to use such websites and so on. And so also the Social Innovation and Entrepreneurship Development Fund, SIE Fund, has funded a total of 504 projects, as well as about and of those 130 projects involve promotion digital inclusion. And then with the Refin platform, we have a new round of programs to promote the use of general technology, because we have a general technology platform set up for this purpose. Thank you. Now we'll be happy to answer questions from members. So far, five colleagues would like to ask questions. 4 minutes each, please, for questions answer. Mr. Lam Chen Sing, Mr. Tang Fei, Mr. Chen Siu Hong, Mr. Chen Kim Po, and Mr. Peter Shiu. First, Mr. Lam Chen Sing. Thank you, Chairman. Now, in the briefing, there's mention of portal for learning about German technology. It seems that the hit rate is quite good. But then it seems that short videos may be uploaded to YouTube, and there are very few views of those videos. There could be two possibilities. That is about the elderly IT learning portal. Well, one reason could be because the elderly would not watch these videos if they already know how to use electronic devices. But then for others who don't know how to use these devices, they probably don't know they could access the YouTube channel for such videos. So since you put in so much effort on these videos and so on, couldn't you do more promotion and publicity, perhaps at the community elderly center? Maybe you shouldn't just promote information to the elderly, but to family members of the elderly. So family members will tell the elderly there are such videos available, and then we could improve the view rate of such videos. Second question, digital finance for the elderly, that's my concern. Now, for the majority of the elderly population, probably they wouldn't have problems, you know, connecting with their friends online. And some surveys show that for elderly persons aged 65 or above, some 60% or 70% of the elderly are actually using smartphone to communicate with their friends. But if you ask them, but the surveys ask if the elderly using technology to make payments or for banking, but then the percentage low, maybe 10% or so. And then they also worry that if they go online for banking to make monetary transactions, maybe it's not secure and they may lose all their money. But you know, so the elderly don't feel safe using online means. But of course, as soon as we're going to have the EMPF platform, and then elderly will have to use mobile app to manage their accounts related to financial services. So can more be done in this respect, maybe at a community care center or at banks? The resources were made available to engage, say, retirees to become ambassadors. They can reach out to the elderly and teach them about such skills. And apart from teaching them skills, the elderly will also be assured that it's safe to use fintech products, for instance. Deputy Secretary or Mr. Wong? Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Lam, for your suggestions. About the on IT learning portal, well, there are so far 34 learning modules, and those short videos are for elderly who, and so they could learn about these skills online according to their own interests and needs. And apart from such information, perhaps individual departments may also upload videos on the YouTube to teach the public to use their services online, for instance. Now, we will keep expanding the number of learning modules on our platform. And if there are certain activities that are suitable for the elderly and that we want to promote, then we will include such modules and we will enrich the content of the learning portal. Now, Mr. Lam suggested we could work more with other organizations. For example, the community care teams, they can help to do more publicity and promotion. And then there are other two measures that we mentioned, for example, home visits or training programs for the elderly. We could also make use of the channels to further promote the learning portal so that more elderly persons will be able to benefit. Can I also answer the question on financial technology for the elderly? Now, Mr. Lam mentioned information about financial services. Well, actually, on our learning portal, there is relevant information and there are also relevant teaching materials for the elderly. Perhaps we will talk to our contractor and they could include more such elements in as they put together learning modules. Mr. Lam suggested us approaching financial organizations. Well, we're actually doing that. There are the elderly who have better IT skills and we have asked them to become our volunteers in the various training programs. So we will certainly take on board Mr. Lam's views. Next, Mr. Tang Fei. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Two questions. And the OSCEO actually organizes many activities to promote IT learning for the elderly, and I'm glad to see that. Now, for such learning portal or training programs, they are very educational, but they're not entertaining enough. I think for the elderly, they're most worried about loneliness. So more entertainment is good for them. You know, for the elderly, watching TV is an important form of entertainment. And also, having close communication with friends and relatives is very important too. You know, young people may be working hard, so they don't have much time for the elderly. So perhaps when we talk about children technology, apart from such or about elderly IT learning portal, can we consider something practical? You know, teaching them how to use streaming service so they can watch a TV drama every night. My mother is good at computer, but so she's also was using streaming service a lot to watch drama series, and actually in overseas countries, there are virtual platforms, so there could be frequent communication with friends and family members overseas all the time. So can you teach the elderly such skills because they are more practical? Now in the Annex 4. I don't quite get it. For the funded projects promoting intergenerational digital inclusion, both elderly and young people benefit. So for young people, they are involved in developing this app or developing the technology products, right? So they will help the elderly, or is it not the case? Perhaps the app or the technology are already available, but then we need young people to teach the elderly how to use these products and apps. So which is it? Which scenario is it? Thank you. OSCEO, GCIO, well, thank you for your support. Actually, you proposed that in our learning portal or training programs, we could include elements involving entertainment. Well, that's a very good suggestion. We will take it up with the contractor to see how we could further enrich our content. And also, Mr. Tan suggested that for practical applications, we could make them more entertaining. Yes, we are also considering it. Maybe we can use more games and make the modules more entertaining, and that will be more interesting for the elderly. So thank you for your suggestions. We'll follow up on that. About promoting intergenerational digital inclusion. Now, apart from engaging the elderly as volunteers to teach other elderly persons about the IT skills using their own first-hand experience, we also work with some different schools, you know, secondary schools, primary schools, or universities, and other groups in the 18 districts. We work with them, and there are youth groups that are also very keen, and so they allow young people to become volunteers to help the elderly. Say they could be assistant trainers. So the young people also benefit because they can learn to about communication skills with the elderly. And as they work as volunteers, they also learn about the technology as well. So here we invite young people to become volunteers so they could assist in the training programs. Thank you.
Chairman, in Annex 4, there are a couple of projects promoting intergenerational digital inclusion. I'd like to invite Ms. Karen Cheng from the Efficiency Office to walk us through these projects. Member mentioned in Annex 4 to the paper, for the four projects regarding the participation of young people, they mainly help elderly people to learn about the application of technology. How many in total? In total, over 400 young people. Where were they recruited? We mainly engaged NGO to help us with the implementation of the project. So NGO was responsible for recruiting these young people. Are they volunteers? Yes, indeed. That is quite good. Next, Mr. Chen Xiuhong. Thank you, Chairman. For the elderly's internet usage rate, it seems to be an important indicator in assessing digital inclusion for the elderly. The figure increased to 82% in 2020. This is indeed very good, as we have already surpassed a target of 75% by 2023. The Leave Home Save was one of the examples. A lot of elderly people were actually not familiar with the use of the mobile phones. Let us do the math. In 2020, in Hong Kong, for persons aged 65, some 1.52 million people. For the remaining 20%, they are not familiar with the internet, so that is close to 300,000 people. For ICT outreach program for the elderly and the Enrich program, for persons aged 65 or above, the figure is 30,000 or so. Divided by people using the internet, only some 10% are using the internet, while the remaining 90% are not using the internet. How can we step up the efforts in this regard? I hope the administration can let us know how you will enhance your efforts in moving faster. So not just 10% will be able to use the internet, probably 30% or 50% will use the internet. That is my first question. Next, the popularization of mobile phones has allowed a lot of elderly people to use the internet. But the use of the internet and information technology is not quite different. Will the administration draw reference from overseas experience or mainland experience in order to set indicators to assess the elderly people's use of the internet? Quality and quantity are equally important. So, how many tens of thousands of people are attending these courses? Do we have any indicator for quality? Do we have any indicators that target both quantity and quality? That is quite, well, difficult. How can we assess quality? Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Chen's comment. From the thematic household survey conducted by the CNSD, we have compiled some statistics. Mr. Chen is correct. In the past 2 years, the internet usage rate for persons aged 65 or above has increased significantly. The government has some measures put in place. And quite a lot of elderly people have already got used to the use of information technology during the epidemic. The elderly people also used mobile phones and information technology, such as the rollout of consumption vouchers. So the usage rate has increased, which is very good. This year, we have already increased our indicator. By 2025, we hope that the internet usage rate will increase from 81.8% to 87%. But of course, we will have to work hard in this respect. We will continue to put in place different measures about digital inclusion, such as outreach programs and training programs. In the coming 2 years, we will conduct more programs to reach different districts, such as mobile outreach activities. This way, we can be in touch with elderly people in the community, and we can also teach elderly people how to use the mobile phones and other mobile phone applications. With the community care teams, we will also enhance our cooperation. Through different organizations in the industry or different community groups, we hope that we can enhance our cooperation so that we can organize more programs with elderly people to increase their use of digital technology. We have an aging society right now. There will be an increasing number of elderly people in the community. They are already using different digital technologies, and we are confident that they will use it more easily, so that the internet usage rate among elderly people will increase. Regarding different indicators to assess the elderly people's use of digital technologies and mobile phones, we can discuss with the relevant departments, such as the CNSD, to see how we can set different indicators. Or how we can add questions about quality in order to gain a better picture of the situation. We will discuss with the CNSD. Thank you, member. Just now, Mr. Wong mentioned that we need to strive for improvements. After elderly people have taken the courses, whether I Am Smart or other government platforms, to make different applications in their daily life, you can calculate the number of times they have used the internet service instead of just counting the number of course attendees. They may as well just ask their family members, their grandsons and granddaughters, to make the online applications for them. That is not enough. Every time we finish our training and visits, we also had follow-up surveys. Indeed, over 95% of the elderly people taking part in the survey or the courses found that the courses are actually on the point. They can help them. But we can try to analyze different applications of the technology in order to have a more accurate understanding of the elderly people's use of the internet. Let me interject. Some mobile apps, the mainland actually has different mobile apps, such as, well, sending red packets, for example. By this SIE fund, there is a program or promoting intergenerational digital inclusion. over 10 million people. Well, that is about getting the red packets. And that is a very good argument. The $12 million actually benefited stakeholders instead of the users. You need to have both the carrot and the stick. Thank you, Mr. Chen. Next, Mr. Chen Kingpor. Thank you, Chairman. In paragraphs 2 and 3, we noticed the increased elderly internet usage rate. In 2020, the internet usage rate was 66%. In 2022, the rate was 82%. And in 2025, your target is to reach 85%. The target is just to increase a couple of percentage points. That is 5% from 82% to 87%. Just 5% in 3 years. Right now, you're going to conduct 300 sessions. How can you fit 300 sections in your schedule? Next, in Annex 2 of the paper, some scammers use artificial intelligence to scam different elderly people using their face or voice. The elderly people are the targets. In the courses of the Enrich ICT training program for the elderly, internet security is involved. But then in mobile stations, internet security is not covered. But that is the basics. I mean, the elderly people must know this. Will we include internet security in these outreach programs? Online scams are widespread. They are rampant. Will we be able to cover these in outreach programs in the community? Thank you, Mr. Chen. On the internet usage rate, we compiled the statistics from CNSC surveys. And the growth of the elderly people's population. In 2021 to 2023, the rate is 81.8%. And we are confident that the elderly's internet usage rate will exceed 85%. We want to take it further, so the target is 87%. That is our estimate, but of course, we will do our level best. This is our target. But we want to see the percentage point going up. But of course, we will complement with different measures. Mr. Chen asked about how to further boost the elderly's internet usage rate and to set a higher target. For the outreach service, what was the reason for the increase? There was a testing point and different organizations also participated in the scheme. Now we have already increased resources. So the target is over 300 mobile outreach service activities. 300 sections of these mobile outreach service programs. For outreach service, internet security was not written down, but Mr. Chen has made a very good point. We will focus on promoting cybersecurity, especially for phone scams. These are quite common topics recently. We will enhance our efforts in this respect. Yes, you can introduce the latest developments or the latest trend. elderly people can make phone calls to double check, to verify, do not fall victim to these scams so easily. We have a close dialogue with the police to see how we can enhance our training materials. But then, in our outreach stations or in community stations, we will also include these contents so that the elderly people will also be briefed on cybersecurity. Well, this is a must-know for them. These are very serious recently. But of course, we cannot just scare them away. But the reality is as such, you have to do this. Next, Mr. Peter Shu.
Thank you, Chairman. Well, Mr. Cheng Kim-po has asked almost all of my questions. That means, we share the same thinking. Now, about the outreach program, in Annex 1 to the paper, you work with different groups, such as the Lutheran group, Women's group, and so on, and you work with various organizations and NGOs. So, what is the mode of cooperation? Do you just give them money, or do you give them manpower, and they give you a performance service pledge or whatever? So how do you work with them? Thank you. Well, in each round, we will openly invite NGOs to submit proposals. And in proposals, they will give us a list of activities for the coming 2 years on the basis of the content in our invitation. And then they will include, and then they will add other information such as their target groups and the funds needed and so on. And then we will do assessment, and then we'll invite the suitable organization to take up the outreach activity for a particular district. So we have to give them a scope of activities so they know exactly what they need to do. And if they want to propose additional services, we will consider those as well. And then we'll also look at the funds they need. And in the process, we will also have regular communication with them. We could also match them to a volunteer service, say certain youth groups or professional groups. They may want to be involved in supporting these activities, and then we will recommend these groups to the NGOs, and hopefully that will enhance the capacity of the NGOs in providing the service. So we work with them mostly as partners. From 2021 to 2023, there are 6 organizations covering 18 districts in Hong Kong. So how many districts do they each take up? Now, when we send out invitation for proposals, we will list out different districts or areas, and then the organization would indicate the district they want to provide service in. That means they will, take up services for a particular district. Of course, they have to tell us what their network is, how come they're able to provide the service in the particular district. So actually, we have divided 18 districts into 6 areas, so each area is taken up by a particular organization. Well, I'm sure these groups are NGOs, they are regularly providing community services, so they have their network to provide these services as well, because that's what they've been doing. But is it possible that there are target groups that they have not served before? For example, in housing, this public housing, this essays, you see old men and women sitting in the park. They may not go to communities, elderly center, or whatever. So you say they will give you a service pledge. Will they also reach out to such elderly persons not joining such centers, and maybe, will you ask them to reach out to the offices of district councillors and national members? Because in these offices, we do serve the community. And also, what about the community care team? Will you give them resources so they could reach out to more people? Thank you. Mr. Xu's suggestion is good. Now, of course, we will allocate our resources based on needs, and they must also, there are also target groups and indicators. For example, there are over 300 mobile teams, support teams. We know, of course, we won't be able to cover all locations in Hong Kong. That's why we'll be actively liaising with the community care teams. Hopefully then, because the teams have a much wider network, they will help us take care of the needs of the elderly better. So so it's just about doing more. There's no limit on the scope that we could cover. What about the demented elderly? How are you going to teach them the skills? Well, I heard from the NGOs providing the services. Usually when they conduct home visits, they would just teach them simple skills on using smartphones. And then by using smartphones, they'll be able to access the internet world better. So just basic tools and skills, you know, just teaching them how to access information on the internet, or teaching them how to use government mobile apps and so on. Has the effort been effective? Well, it's hard for us to try to assess the effectiveness for each and every outreach activity, but then according to the NGOs, the elderly have benefited much. They are keen to learn such new skills. So we'll give them training based on their needs. Next, Ms. Elizabeth Court. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Well, I feel very deeply about digital inclusion. Since 2021, Mr. Wong, we've worked together to promote digital inclusion. Actually, it was 22 years ago that we started working together. I was the president of the Internet Professional Association. And we found at the time that new arrivals and the elderly may fall behind in the use of digital technology. That's why we try to promote digital inclusion. Well, in those days, that is 20 years ago, only 10% or so the elderly knew how to use the internet. Now the usage rate has gone up to over 80%. That's progress, although it's taken a long time to get to that level. Now, I have a number of questions. First one, the outreach program, I support it because that will allow the elderly opportunities to experience the use of technology and also to try their hands at some of the technology and apps and so on. So it's good. And then I see you're using augmented reality, but it's more in the form of exhibition. But I think for the elderly, what is most important is that they know how to use their smartphones and how they could use the mobile apps. Now, whenever the government asks people to register for something, there are always long lines forming in our offices because our volunteers, our staff have to work very hard. They're doing the work of the government to help the elderly to register, say, to get the voucher or whatever. So don't just focus on exhibitions. Of course, exhibitions are good, but then most importantly, you need to help the elderly to learn how to use a smartphone to meet their day-to-day needs. You must teach them how to use IM Smart, how to register, and you have to teach them to use search engine because they need information. They always ask us for information. And then the EHR, you have to teach them how to use it, and on how they can have video calls with family members, and different apps. They need to learn how to use them, or entertainment, how they could access online entertainment, you know, registering on different platforms and so on. If they learn to do all this, it will be already a lot of fun for them. But then if you can't help them to access these platforms on using the mobile phones, even if you show them new experience, new technology, to them it's just a one-off game that they play. I think what is important is to teach them how to use their smartphones. Now, in future, there will be community care teams reaching out to each and every household, visiting the elderly. So if you have some sort of trainer courses, so you could train volunteers and then they could teach the elderly how to use their smartphones. I think the community care teams could do that, and all of our members' offices will be happy to do that, but we don't have the resources. I see that each year, you say 20 elderly persons will benefit, but 20,000 elderly persons, for them, it's just one-off experience. But what? How many of them would actually learn how to know how to use the smartphones after the experience? So it shouldn't be about quantity, it's about quality. That means how well the elderly have been taught to use their smartphones for the convenience of the day-to-day life. I think you should move in that direction. If I could say a bit more, sorry, Mr. Chairman, on the web and mobile app accessibility, I'm rather disappointed. Since 2021, while you've been doing promotion, now the government has over 600 websites for the private sector. There are just a few hundred websites. Even my own website is accessible. But then for the websites in the private sector or in other public sectors, there are just a few hundred accessible websites. But then for people who need to access service, for example, the visually impaired, they definitely need accessible websites. And for all these groups, if they don't have accessible websites, they are failing their job. So that's why for all groups are providing services to those with disabilities, they need to make sure that their websites are accessible. And but then the government's not been promoting hard in the past years on the benefits of accessible websites, because they will help those in need. Now, it's not just about using technology online to help the disabled. You know, for the visually impaired, it's the case in physical environment as well. Well, shopping malls, well, they are privately owned, but even for government premises, the visually impaired has mentioned that there is no accessible, say, map for them and so on. So now it's not that difficult to have interactive and accessible map. So for the visually impaired, they could use their smartphones to access accessible services or barrier-free services. Now for those who couldn't afford to buy smartphones, would the government give them subsidy? So the for persons with disabilities, they'll be able to use the latest technology, digital technology. If I may respond, thank you, Ms. Quart, for your views on outreach services. Yes, we've heard what you say. We'll focus more on teaching the elderly applications. We're doing that already in our training programs, and in our outreach program, we could also enrich the content. So the elderly will be able to experience the use of different apps in these outreach sessions. But of course, for those who are interested, they should actually join our training programs to learn the skills. Now, I've also replied to the points of other members that we will actively discuss some cooperation with the community team, care team. And Ms. Quart has made a good suggestion, that is, we could prepare some training packages. So when the care teams approach the elderly, they would have been trained in a standard manner. Ms. Quart, of course, is very much committed to helping the government to publicize new government tools or apps. You try to help the elderly to install these apps, and so we thank you for that. And in any case, we will also enhance our support in this respect. Now, apart from the government, we could all work together. to help the elderly in need so they could learn more about digital skills and promote digital, so we could promote digital inclusion. On web and app accessibility, yes, we see that for commercial organizations, if they want to provide accessibility, they need to upgrade their websites and the functions of their apps as well. So we need to do more promotion in that respect. Together, with the Hong Kong Internet Registration Corporation Limited, when we work with them on the recognition scheme each year, we will ask also if there are groups that are more concerned about certain online services. For example, in August 2021, in that round of the recognition scheme, we visited some groups of persons with disabilities, and we found that for the media services and financial services, they find such apps useful. So that's why in this year's recognition scheme, we are actually inviting more providers from these two sectors to join our scheme. So we're glad that some financial groups and so on have joined this scheme. So we'll be doing more promotion in that respect. Mostly we are considering service contents that the persons with disabilities need, and so they will be able to benefit. Thank you. Next, Mr. Michael Locke.
2 years ago, I have conducted a survey about digital confidence. Whether elderly people can use the internet, can use e-payment, there has been quite a lot of change, I believe. The elderly people have certainly made improvements. Over half of the elderly people do not know how to use e-payment on mobile phone except Octopus. So we can see the situation 2 years ago, the digital divide was actually quite large. The government is still working on this with the increased internet usage of elderly people. I believe some elderly people can already use the mobile apps on mobile phones. At least elderly people can use the real-time messaging apps and e-payment, as well as transportation apps, online shopping apps, mobile apps, etc. There is no comprehensive survey right now. Can the Office of the Government Chief Information Officer set up an indicator of digital confidence among elderly people so that we can have an understanding of the application of information technology among elderly people, whether they can move with the times? We will have a better picture of the situation with the normal travel with mainland right now. There are quite a lot of different options or choices in relation to information technology. Some elderly people do not know how to use these apps. Can we also organize some courses teaching elderly people to use the common mobile apps in the mainland? At least they need to know how to use e-payment. Otherwise, they cannot make payment in the mainland. There is no change, including transportation. You need to buy tickets for railways. You need to hail a taxi. You need to do online shopping, and so on. You just cannot do all these without a mobile phone. It's all about integration into the GBA. In the future courses to be conducted by the Office of the Government Chief Information Officer, especially in the enriched ICT training program for the elderly, can we hold a mainland version teaching elderly people about the situation in the mainland? Then we can engage some organizations to be responsible for these courses. the airport authority has actually got a lot of courses for employees. Can the OGCIO do this as well, such as organizing some courses for elderly people? There are only 6,300 or so elderly people joining the Enrich program. If we can solicit the support of different community organizations, I believe that there will be probably 63,000 elderly people benefiting from this program. We are a little bit pushed for time. Still one more member going to ask a question. Next, Mr. Dennis Lan. Please press the button if you wish to speak. I will draw a line soon. Mr. Dennis Leung, please. Mr. Tony Wong, yes, please. Thank you, Mr. Lok, for your comment. Regarding the survey, Mr. Lok mentioned 2 years ago, some 50% of the elderly people did not have much digital confidence. The CNSD told us that some 65% of the elderly people use the internet. The figure is similar because of different reasons. More elderly people are using the internet. In my answer to another member's question, we will discuss with the CNSD to see how we can incorporate these elements into the future surveys so that we will have an understanding of how the elderly people are using these digital technologies with confidence. We have taken on board members' view. We will add this in our survey. In our training course contents, we will try our best to include more elements about the GBA. These will benefit elderly people. We will discuss with our teams to see how we can add these elements. On engaging more organizations to help elderly people, to help train them. Looking ahead, we will cooperate with community care teams. They have a very wide network covering all 18 districts in Hong Kong. We will try to exhaust our resources to work on this front. Next, Mr. Dennis Leung. Thank you, Chairman. I am a consultant of New Territory West Elder Academy, and I will also be a member of the community care team. On digital confidence, I'd like to ask the OGCIO, can your positioning be clear? Are you targeting working elderly people? Different levels, elementary level, advanced level, and so on. So that you can help different elderly people get the hang of using digital technologies. Otherwise, these will not benefit them. You won't be able to encourage them to use smartphones. They may still be using traditional phones. In NS1 of the paper, you provided us with a lot of figures. Can you show us the ratio? For example, for elderly people in the RCHE, some 10,000 elderly people. So how many RCHEs have actually benefited? 10,000 odd elderly people. What is the percentage? There is no information about the percentage. Then I cannot assess the penetration or the effectiveness of the scheme. In 2021, for elderly people aged 65 or above, they accounted for some 20% of the entire population. That is some 1.5 million people. What about the elderly people in the bracket between 60 and 64? There is no such information. Regarding other programs, the number of beneficiaries is actually quite different. $2,000 for some programs. But for some programs, It may be as high as 12,000 or so. That is, I mean, the ratio between elderly people benefiting from the program and youth participation. Some ratio is as high as 1 to 12, whereas some is low as 1 to 2.4. I'd like to have more information about this. Right now, the ITIB is working on this. But the LWB is also putting in place different programs. Do we have relevant information? Can they put in place similar programs like your bureau does? Sometimes there needs to be declaration of these programs, whether you have conducted these programs. Are there such guidelines? Otherwise, they are actually just using the expenditure to organize the very same courses or programs. Then it is the organizations that will be benefiting from the program. Do we have the relevant guidelines so that LegCo members can better monitor the situation or the organizations? I do want the elderly people to be able to benefit from these programs. I want the elderly people to be able to use these digital technologies. So we want to know whether the service providers are slacking off or whether they are actually providing the very same programs. And these are our concerns. Thank you, Mr. Dennis Leung. First, I will talk about the outreach programs and the enrich programs for the elderly people and their positioning. Mr. Dennis Leung also asked about some other programs, and I will invite my colleague from the Efficiency Office to supplement on these. For the two programs, first of all, for the outreach program, there are mobile teams going to different districts. We want to attract more elderly people so that they will know the benefits of using digital technologies. First of all, they need to know that these technologies are actually beneficial to them. Then they will take an interest in using these technologies. We will also briefly teach them how to use these technologies. Our outreach team goes to different RCHEs, or they will have different home visits to add these elements. For the enrich program, they are more practical. When elderly people are interested, they take courses, they learn how to use the apps, such as the apps of the government or common apps like e-payment or streaming apps, information apps, how they can search for information online or how they can communicate with their relatives or family members. We can teach them all these through the Enrich training program. Regarding the number of RCHEs, I do not have the figures or ratio at hand, but then we do have such analysis. We can provide these figures after the meeting. We can share with members later. For the other question, I will invite Ms. Karen Sheng from the Efficiency Office to take the question. Thank you, Chairman. In Annex 4, for the four projects mentioned, in 2021, we actually invited organizations to apply with us. In considering their proposals, there were several major principles. First of all, we needed to see whether the goals are in line with our principles. We want to promote intergenerational digital inclusion. We also took a look at the design and the timetable of their schemes. And of course, we also considered cost effectiveness, according to the information provided by the four organizations, the progress is actually quite good. In Q1 next year, these programs will finish. The figures have already reached our target. And we believe that this have been instrumental in promoting digital inclusion. Any information about declaring whether they have held such programs in the past? Yes, we do. In considering the proposals submitted by the organizations, as we mentioned, we needed to take a look at the track record of the organizations. They did provide us with the relevant information for our reference. So you will also see whether they have held the relevant programs in the past. Yes. Will you provide further information to our members to see? Well, I mean to let us know the latest situation. Yes, we will prepare for these. We have finished this agenda item. Thank you, Secretary.
Next item on the agenda, item 4, the work and latest development of Radio Television Hong Kong. First, can we invite the administration and the representatives of the RTHK to join us? If members wish to ask questions, please press the request to speak button. So 4 minutes each for questions and answers. Welcome, Secretary. Welcome, Director. Last month, we visited the RTHK. Yes, there is indeed much room for improvement. So let's get started when you are ready. Well, before the presentation, perhaps I can tell you what members think after that visit. We said that RTHK needs additional resources for various improvement on manpower, on hardware, facilities, and so on. And of course, we know that we are talking about public resources, so there are various considerations. We couldn't just, be a big spender. And of course, an important mission for HK is to tell good stories of the country and Hong Kong. It's a good platform for doing that. And I see that there are quite a number of innovative programs of the RTHK recently. So it's important that we tell good stories. And how we can make sure resources are put to good use to achieve the relevant targets, well, that's of concern to us too. I see that RTHK has some big staff, but then there's not enough space though. But at the same time, then we have the Information Services Department with much resources. So one is like the soul, the other is like the body, the two are now separated. So is there a possibility for the soul and the body to come together as one again? Then we could make better use of public resources. I think we explored that in the previous term of this council, but we haven't yet come to any conclusion. So perhaps the Reverend department could submit some information for us so we could explore how we could make more effective use of the resources of the RTHK and the Information Services Department. Of course, the RTHK comes under the CDB and the ISD comes under the Home and Youth Affairs Bureau. Well, these are two separate policy bureaus, but then they are all under the same government. And so we have joint panel meetings. It's all about what we can do better for the public. 10 members have indicated they wish to ask questions. So I'll read out the list. Lam Shan Ting, Chan Siu Hong, Lo Wai Kwok, Duncan Chiu, Lee Chan Kang, Kenneth Falk, Tan Fei, Tannis Leung, Elizabeth Court, and Peter Shill. 4 minutes each, please. I will, you know, watch the time carefully. I understand the Bureau wants to show a video, right? Yes, yeah, so let me first speak, and then the Director of Broadcasting will speak and show you and show your video. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for your views. We hope we'll be able to respond to that later. Now, I'm very much grateful to the Chairman and members for visiting the RTHK last month. This allows the RTHK the chance to brief you on their work, and also, and you could also have a first-hand experience on the operations of the RTHK today. It's a good opportunity for us to have further discussion on the focus of work and the latest development of the RTHK. We would like to hear your views further. Now, the RTHK launched a number of major reforms. So to make sure that this is the RTHK is again functioning as a government department and the sole public service broadcaster in Hong Kong. We have make sure that our services fulfill the public purposes and missions stipulated in the charter of the RTHK. In particular, it's important for RTHK to promote the understanding of the concept One Country, Two Systems and its implementation in Hong Kong, as well as the understanding of our community and the nation. The RTHK has also actively followed up on the implementation of various improvement recommendations of the governance and management of the RTHK review report released in February 2022. Such areas include editorial management, performance management, and so on. There have been reforms to make sure that our resources are used properly to meet in line with public interest. And in the past few years, we have been engaging in a number of tasks. For example, we have many programs on talking about our country's history and achievements. For example, short videos on the night on national anthem, and also we have we've been broadcasting popular TV drama series on the mainland too. And then we have also been working closely with the China Media Group and Greater Bay Area Media Groups since 2020. One and 22, we are using RTHK TV 33 and 34 to relay programs from CCTV 1 and CGTN documentary. We are also relaying programs of radio, the Greater Bay of CMG. And then I am glad to have the opportunity to meet with the relevant officials of these groups, and there will be further cooperation that will include the broadcasting of exquisite programs gifted by the CMG and documentaries featuring local characteristics to be co-produced with the NCMG. For example, the documentary A Taste of Hong Kong will be co-produced to provide, and then there will be the new RTHK TV 35, and this will allow people to further understand about the developments on the mainland that will help to further promote the bonds of people on the two sides of, and also telling good stories about the nation and Hong Kong is another important task of the RTHK. We are fully enhancing our function as a cross-media multi-language broadcasting, and then we will be featuring the latest developments of the country, and we'll promote that to all parts of the world. And then on youth nurturing, promoting sports, and so on, we also are working on that, and we'll also be actively and improving our technology. Now, I would like to invite Mr. Eddie Jung, Director of Broadcasting, to brief you further on the work of the Arctic Chair, and then we'll be happy to answer questions thereafter. Thank you. Perhaps in future panel meetings, you could include an item about enhancing the synergy between the RTHK and ISD, because for our next meeting on the 9th of October, we only have one agenda item. If there is enough time for you, perhaps you could respond to this issue at that meeting. Maybe the HYAB, the ISD, can also be invited to join the meeting, and so we could further consider how we could create more energy between ISD and RTHK, and so we could tell good stories of Hong Kong and the nation. Thank you. We'll follow up on that suggestion. Thank you. Director, please. Yes. The RTHK provides both radio and TV services, so the best way to tell you about our work is through a short video. This is the latest edition of video, so let me show you the video. Now, RTHK was established in 1928, the only public service broadcaster in Hong Kong. We have 8 FM and AM channels. FM 926, that's RTHK Radio 1. And then Radio 2. Radio 3. Apart from news reporting, on our website, we have we also have mobile apps to provide news services. And then on we have evening news every night too on our RTHK TV 31. The TV sections department was set up in 1970. It provides some education and other quality programs. And RTHK TV 31, it's about current affairs, education, young people and children, arts and culture, so and history as well. So this is a general information channel. And our RTHK 32 is the general information channel. This is to enhance transparency of government information. This is to provide the latest and the most up-to-date and accurate information about the government. RTHK 33 relays programs from CCTV, and RTHK 34 relays programs of the CGTN documentary. And the latest RTHK TV 35, it will relay the English channel of CCTV. So our new media services cover all aspects. So we make use of the social media, internet, and so on, so people overseas can receive information and also access our programs anytime and anywhere. And we will also be expanding the application of 5G so that we could achieve a low latency and high capacity and great flexibility in providing our services. This is to ensure the enhances capacity, speed, and reliability of video transmission. We also have plans to use cloud technology to improve operation efficiency and reduce spatial requirements brought by the use of hardware facilities. Now, the RTHK has always been producing a variety of programs to provide information, education, and entertainment to the public. We tell good stories of the nation. We bring in high quality programs on mainland with a Hong Kong element. This we bring new experience to the audience. The RTHK tell good stories of Hong Kong, so people can appreciate the bright sides of Hong Kong. And then we have English language programs as well to promote the achievements of Hong Kong. So people who live inside or outside Hong Kong, of all nationalities, they will learn more about Hong Kong through our programs and learn about our advantages as well. We also produce programs on promoting the constitution, basic law, and national security law, because in the charter, we need to fulfill the public purposes and mission included therein. So we want to promote the understanding of a concept of one country, two systems, and also enhance the sense of national identity. We also pay attention to young youth programs. So we also give opportunity to young people to seize upon different opportunities in the community. We want to promote the sense of national identity. And we want young people with positive thinking. We also have community engagement broadcasting service. We want to engage the community in our producing our programs. We want to promote inclusiveness in the community. We also want to encourage creativity. We have always been producing programs on promoting inclusion. So we tell people about the different cultures and customs of people of different ethnicities and so on. We want people to embrace an inclusive community. We have actually sign language interpretation for most of our programs. We also have multi-language subtitles and dubbing. On promoting sports, we've done much too. We broadcast various sports programs, school competitions and sports games and so on. We also produce programs on athletes. And we want to encourage public interest in sports and also want to encourage public participation in sports. And then we have the weather forecast program that makes use of artificial intelligence. So AIDA will always tell you about the latest weather forecast. We want to make sure that transmission signals cover all parts of Hong Kong. So the RTHK is responsible for managing the infrastructure facilities for all transmission facilities, that is the 7 FM and 2 AM transmission stations, as well as 18 of the 29 territorial digital transmission stations. This is to meet the needs of RTHK, as also other operators such as commercial radio, TVB, Metro Broadcast, and also other government departments, so on. Well, we need to ensure round-the-clock operations, so it's important that we have continuity in all weathers. Even when there's typhoon signal 8 or black rainstorm, we have maintenance teams on the standby. And if necessary, we will also send our team to other stations for emergency repairs. Now, Hong Kong, RTHK is the only public service broadcaster in Hong Kong, so we need to fulfill our community missions so that we are able to meet the public purposes and missions stipulated in the Charter of RTHK. We need to take care of the needs of different groups and sectors in the community.
咁就
We are pushed for time. I wanted to give 4 minutes, but now 3 minutes. Let's get down to business. First, Mr. Lam Chin Sing. Thank you, Chairman. Chairman led us to visit the RTHK. The building is quite old. There is quite limited working space for employees. It is quite dilapidated. In case of typhoon or rainy weather, there may be water leakage. The working environment leaves much to be desired. I understand that employees have the sense of mission, but we do want to see an improvement in the working environment. On the manpower strength of RTHK. Originally, there are 735 civil servants. Right now, the figure stands as 596, and the vacancy stands as 139 right now. The percentage is actually quite high compared with other government departments. Will this impact on the operation of RTHK? Is there any way to enhance recruitment efforts? Can you encourage university graduates to apply for RTHK positions? Right now, the government allows university students who are going to graduate in the next year to apply for a government position. If RTHK needs to enhance its efforts in recruitment, can RTHK consider this method as well? Thank you, member. For the new building of RTHK, we have been conducting a study to see whether it can handle long-term needs. We are studying the progress with RTHK, and we want to have a plan available soon. About the building, we will introduce the plan to LegCo, so the members will have an understanding of the building. We are still working on the details. At a later stage, when we have the plan, we will introduce a plan to members. On the manpower strain, I will invite Mr. Eddie Zhang to take this question. Thank you, Chairman. Mr. Lam mentioned that there is about 20% of vacancy within our grade or within our establishment. Right now, we have 156 full-time non-civil service positions. We have also started rounds of recruitment in order to fill the vacancies. As members said, we have been proactively working with ETOs to promote our recruitment exercises going on. We also have plans to hold recruitment exercises targeting journalism students. We will also leverage on technologies to reduce the demand for manpower. Next, Mr. Chen Xiuhong. Thank you, Chairman. RTHK will produce more programs to tell the good stories of Hong Kong and of our country. I am in full support of this. RTHK is making improvements, as the charter of the RTHK sets out. RTHK has to deepen understanding of citizens about the country. But I'd like to point out, to facilitate citizens' engagement with international affairs, such as Belt and Road Initiative. While the exquisite programs gifted by the CMG are not sufficient, RTHK should prepare more programs or produce more programs from the perspective of citizens. Does RTHK have other plans? Well, that is the documentary targeting poverty alleviation in China. Hong Kong people actually feel deeply about this situation. Hong Kong has to open its door towards the world. CGTN is of very good quality. English is very important. But I don't think CGTN should just purchase programs from outside. Have you considered collaborating with CGTN to produce more English programs? About program production. Thank you, Chairman. I will invite Mr. Eddie Zhang to take the question on program production. Thank you, Chairman. I agree with member. RTHK should also produce programs about the development of country. We have been working very closely with mainland media groups, with CCTV. We will produce a program called A Taste of Hong Kong. We will also produce programs about the GBA with Guangzhou counterparts. We are discussing with some very eminent groups. Other programs, we will make announcement after firming up the details. From Monday to Friday, there will be a one-hour English program from 9:30 to 10:30 with Trade Development Council and Hong Kong Productivity Council. We have collaboration with them. And we will introduce the achievements of Hong Kong to citizens in English so that those interested in investing in Hong Kong, they will also be able to know these programs, such as Vibrant Hong Kong, we will continue to produce such programs in the future. In Belt and Road Initiative, Hong Kong has a very important role. Chief Executive went to Israel. Well, actually, RTHK can consider producing program about culture of Israel, such as Islamic culture and their situation. Dr. Lo Wai Kwok, in a meeting, I criticized RTHK for wasting the resources, and I feel that they have not yet made good use of their resources, and I support having a digital TV channels. They can actually purchase a lot of programs from overseas. 4 years ago, why was I so angry? Why did I say that they are wasting their resources? There were actually scenes of turtles moving very slowly. There were no narrations. And I actually received a very... Well, I mean, their reply was that it was slow TV. I was not satisfied with the reply. On the training of the youth, well, I have to commend RTHK. 4 years ago, I was very angry and I took RTHK to task, but today I need to commend RTHK. On training the youth, especially on encouraging them to learn STEAM. They can also consider STEAM. What has RTHK done? Maybe RTHK can introduce their efforts to us. Thank you, Dr. Lo. Thank you for your comment. This proves the change of RTHK. We thank RTHK staff for making all these improvements. On the question about STEAM, I will invite Mr. Eddie Zhang to take the question. Thank you, Dr. Lo, for your recognition of our work on STEAM. We have produced program about scientists in Hong Kong. We introduced the achievements of scientists in Hong Kong. There is also a program about innovation and technology. They make good use of new technologies to develop their own businesses. We relate, well, the forum of the Vice President of the Hong Kong U. It is the first time that world-class scholars, experts came to Hong Kong U to have a discussion, including the Nobel Prize winner. We also held a robotics competition of secondary school students. There are two programs which we can introduce to members as well. In October, there will be a new program about future scientists. We will broadcast this event soon. Towards the end of this year, we will produce yet another program, which is not only a prize presentation ceremony, we will also introduce their achievements, so that secondary and primary school students will also have an idea about their achievements. We have produced a new program. It introduces knowledge about physics and chemistry, and we hope that they can interest secondary and primary school students. To promote STEAM materials, there are actually a lot of choices, such as engineering, infrastructures. There are quite a lot of world-class items or projects, and I believe that they can be very good materials. Next, Mr. Duncan Chiu. RTHK has made a lot of improvements about contents And RTHK has also produced quite a lot of programs about telling the good stories of China and Hong Kong. We have worked a lot on technology. There are a lot of examples in the engineering field. In terms of contents, using AI to present weather, but what about hardware of video production, such as virtual reality? It is more environmentally friendly. They do not have to dismantle the equipment or the backdrop and so on. They do not have to go outside to shoot the programs. This may be beneficial to program production. Next, there are quite a lot of new attempts. For example, in sports, there are inter-school competitions about basketball, football, and so on. We need to engage the youth. The youth are probably using word media, such as UGC. We can probably work on the television front. Can there be a television channel broadcasting local football matches, local sports, local cultural activities? This can better engage the youth. They will feel a sense of participation. Through the audit of RTHK, if RTHK considers a program suitable, then this can serve as a platform for the youth to upload their own programs online. This may be very attractive to the youth.
Director, thank you. This is a very good suggestion. First, about TV. Yes, we'll look into that. We actually have a plan. By the end of the year, hopefully we can have an IG account, because we find that young people like to go to IG to watch sports programs. So we would like to have sports forum on IG. And then on technology, the current trend is AI plus 5G plus 4K and 8K. We are, you know, studying the technological trend. And then LED walls, we're going to acquire these walls in two stages. First, there will be smaller walls for use in our studios. And as Mr. Yao suggested, it could it is actually cost-saving and is also environmentally friendly, because then we don't need to keep changing the backdrop. And then the other is larger scale LED walls for so that we don't need to do location shooting. But then we can say, but instead we can show, say, the Palace Museum in the backdrop. But of course that's costs more, and so that will be stage two of our work. Next, Mr. Lee Chan Kang. We can all see the progress of the Arctic chain in the past few years. But of course, we need to give them proper resources too. I am all for the Bureau actively considering a new site for the Arctic chain, for example, the Cheung Kwan O Industrial Estate. I understand you have taken back some premises, media premises, or even in the Northern Metropolis, there could be sites for RTHK, say, in the Sentin Technopole. Now, I see that you are relaying many mainland programs, but then these are often official programs. Perhaps it's not so interesting or fun. But in fact, you know, on the mainland, there are many TV broadcasters. They have good variety shows. They also cover the development of the country, culture, and poverty alleviation, and so on. So would you consider also relaying programs from these broadcasters? And they could be interesting. For example, singing contest and so on. That's the first question. Second question. Of course, the RTHK has to tell good stories of Hong Kong. So maybe you could use the Weixin blog and WeChat to broadcast our activities. For example, last weekend we have the Hong Kong Harbour Chill Carnival along the Wan Chai waterfront, but no one knew about it. So perhaps you could use the mini programs of WeChat to broadcast such programs, or you could push notifications to people's phones so we know what's going on in Hong Kong every day, include in particular government activities. And then on LED walls on government premises, you could show news reports or important speeches, say, of President Xi and so on. And then we're going to have the community care teams. How can you ask them to help you promote your programs? I understand there's also community engagement in programs. So maybe the community care teams could help you promote that. Or you could include this on the mini programs on WeChat or the Weibo blog, and then people will learn more about it. Thank you. The director has been visiting different TV broadcasters on the mainland for collaboration opportunities. So because we want to enrich the content and the variety of programs to be relayed to Hong Kong. So we are thinking about bringing in more programs that are interesting and covering a wide range of subjects. And then the director could answer the rest of the questions. Yes, please be brief. A few years ago, we started multimedia broadcasting. Yes, we do have a Weibo account that we update from time to time. And for YouTube and IG, they are the more popular platforms in Hong Kong, so we do show programs there. For example, Vibrant Hong Kong is about a half-hour episode, so we split them up into 5 minutes or 1 minute for broadcasting on these various social media channels. Yeah, so we are definitely moving in that direction. I know you're exploring different types of programs, but you need to have a theme. For example, now we're talking about Happy Hong Kong, Hello Hong Kong. Can you, promote Hong Kong, using these themes? Thank you. Mr. Kenneth Kwok, the last government broadcasted the Tokyo Olympic Games for the first time. It worked very well. Now, the government paid for the broadcasting right, but then RHA was not involved in program production, and I found it strange. But anyway, the Paris Olympics is coming up next. So I hope you will consider the same arrangement again, because it worked really well last time. But then, apart from paying for the broadcasting rights, will the RHA involved in program production? So please consider that. And then more importantly, in the next, and also there will be the National Games in Hong Kong. I think it's going to host at least eight different events, competition events. So will the RHK be fully prepared for the 2025 National Games? Because it's important that you produce quality programs in relation to the games. So have you got the manpower and the resources to do that? And I think that's an important test for testing whether you are able to, fulfill your mission properly. And then on technology, now in the GBA, there are many major tech giants. There are many tech giants in the Shenzhen, and they actually have a TV production base with augmented reality. So you could either invest in such facilities yourself, or you could make use of such facilities in the GBA. And then you could make savings in terms of investment and maintenance. Three questions. Director, please. Thank you. major sports events. Yes, we will consider different options. We will be actively involved, in particular for the 2025 National Games. Hong Kong is one of the co-organizers. In fact, the government has set up a high-level committee to prepare for this event. The Director of Broadcasting is a member on the committee. We are already making preparations in terms of manpower resources. There's mention of a large LED wall for augmented reality productions. We hope that before 2025, the wall will be ready. And then it will help us to produce better programs for the National Games. Thank you. And on the application of technology on the mainland, last week we went to Guangzhou to visit the technology city. Well, it's true, we could rent such TV production facilities to save costs, and we are actually exploring that. Mr. Dennis Leung, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. RTC has been producing policy programs over the years. But then we could only review programs for the past year alone. And for older programs, unless someone recorded these programs and then they put up these videos, on certain channels, then we would find it. For example, some very old programs. But then how can the RTHK allow the public to access such valuable resources? People can then review or watch again old programs. What about, like a TV box? You could sell TV boxes to the public and people can then access the old programs, because those were good programs, and you need to remind people about the quality of programs, and then you shouldn't allow access to programs for just 1 year. You should allow access for a much longer period, because the public, especially the elderly, they don't know how to search for the older programs. And so you can perhaps consider a TV box, and that will help to better promote the programs of the RTHK. So have you got such plans? I'll invite Ms. Chan, the Assistant Director, to respond. Thank you, Mr. Leung, for your questions. There are a few ways for people to watch past programs. First, podcast is on our own website. The other is the archive on the webcast. And third channel is YouTube. Actually, all programs are stored for a year for now. But then for some special programs of very good quality, will be stored for 3 years. As for podcasts, we have programs for more than 10 years. But perhaps the technology was not as good then, so we do have an internal discussion on enhancing our podcast and archive so we could have better compression for better streaming. So thank you for your questions. Actually, we have an app, RTHK Memory, and some of our classic programs are included there, like Under the Line Rock and other programs featuring Chow Yun-fat and so on. But of course, we know we need to step up our publicity. Thank you. Three other members, so I'll draw the line here. Ms. Elizabeth Quart, thank you. Now, after its repositioning and going back on the right track, I am happy with the latest positioning of the RTHK. Its mission is to tell good stories of the country and Hong Kong, and also it should focus on youth nurturing. I think those are important duties of the RTHK, and I support that. Now, some members mentioned that RTHK has produced some very good programs. Last time when we visited the RTHK, we saw the treasure trove of the RTHK. They have years of RTHK programs, news programs, all, kept in the archive. And they have also music records as well. So they do have huge treasure. And when at the visit, we were concerned, what if there's a flood, whatever, then such treasure might vanish. I know you have risk management strategy in place. You keep such items at different locations, but it seems that the sourish condition is not all that desirable. Now, when the RHK first asked to build a new building, at the timing was right. At the time, the positioning of the RHK was not right, and there were plenty of complaints about RHK. Also, the proposal was too extravagant at the time. That's why the proposal was voted down. But now, perhaps, it's time for you to consider very carefully the new complex for the RHK. I hope it will be something practical, that will meet the needs of the RHK. And then you could put forward such a proposal to us for consideration. If it's reasonable, I believe there's no reason we would reject it. And also, making good use of technology is important. You know, technology is advancing rapidly. We have artificial intelligence, we have new technologies emerging. There are also new production methods and so on. I believe that these are all important for the development of RTHK. So again, we will support the RTHK in such advancement. We hope the RTHK will work harder and make greater progress, and then you can tell good stories of the country and Hong Kong. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Quartz. The administration will definitely study with RTHK about its new building, and we hope that we will garner your support. Next, Mr. Peter Shill. Thank you, Chairman. I've heard the support from members. Well, the then Director of Broadcasting was facing a very different situation back then. Well, I believe that it was quite a great challenge to turn the situation around. Members recognize the efforts of the RTHK. And your efforts are recognized by members. There are quite a lot of different new programs. I myself have also watched these programs last time. Chairman led us to RTHK for a visit, and I was also one of the participants. Thank you for greeting us. As we saw, the building was actually quite old. It was still, it was still tidy though. Well, for the glass in the male's toilet, it was quite dirty. You should replace it. We often talk about ESG, and we need to take care of the needs of employees. There is a plan of a new building block, but then it's not going to happen so soon. So the Secretary should devote more resources to improving the environment of RTHK. For the transitional period, what will it be? You need a transitional period before the new building block is completed. For the current building block, it is worth over $10 billion. How will you deal with it? Thank you, member. Of course, we will take care of the needs of RTHK employees. When we have any updates about the moving of the building block of RTHK, we will update you in due course. Throughout the process, you should devote more resources. We will monitor the situation. Well, I hope that the glass in the male's the mirror in the male's toilet will be replaced. Mr. Lok Chung Hong, as long as you are committed to it, then you will make it. Otherwise, you are just going to have a lot of excuses. Back then, in 2018, I went to RTHK with some football association representatives. We asked, can RTHK broadcast different football matches? Can you help promote football in Hong Kong? Back then, RTHK was very bureaucratic. There was a lack of resources. There was copyright issues involving another mainstream media outlet. There are a lot of other issues such as signals, etc. In short, it could not be done. That is the most important football match in Hong Kong. But RTHK was not willing to relate it. After the new director took office, the situation turned around. There are quite a lot of football matches being broadcast by RTHK. A lot of local sporting events, basketball, volleyball, inter-school competitions are also broadcast on RTHK. This is actually a great confidence boost to local athletes. So that's why I said as long as you are committed to it, you will make it. For the reconstruction of the new building block of RTHK, RTHK needs to produce more programs, such as the new Under the Lion Rock. Several episodes are actually very much in touch with the reality. And I think that they are of international standard. RTHK does need resources and equipment to produce good programs, so we are looking forward to the expansion and the construction of the new building block of RTHK. For the live broadcast of sporting events, I'm not sure whether there is copyright concern, but there is no replay on RTHK or on this website. I myself am also a fan of football matches. We can only watch the matches live. There is no replay of the football matches. The website says there is no replay of these football matches. I'm not sure whether these are copyright concerns. How can we promote sports in Hong Kong? We need to maximize the promotional effect of sports in Hong Kong. Thank you, member. Thank you for your support for our new building block. We will update you when we have the updates. I will now invite Mr. Vincent Lee, Assistant Director, to take members' question. Yes, it's about copyright concern, as you mentioned. For local matches, the replay will be aired on Channel 32 in the evening, after the match in the morning. If there are no other programs on Channel 32, then we will play the rematch on Channel 32. On channels 31 and 32, we have cut short some video clips about table tennis matches so that the audience can watch the essence of the table tennis matches online. We will continue to liaise with different sports associations to see whether we can relay the broadcast or the replay. Mr. Vincent Chang, while I want to air my views on RTHK topics, I am helping RTHK with sports matters. But I think the RTHK staff is very professional. They are very dedicated. And I believe RTHK has room to produce more programs to provide other options for citizens of Hong Kong. I am particularly concerned about cultural aspect. What I mean for local sports, local athletics meets, if you can live broadcast in these athletic meets, then this will be very encouraging to students or for arts and culture performance. With local basketball, football matches, or inter-school sport competitions, these will be very good options as well. Hong Kong is East Meets West cultural center. A lot of arts groups deserve the promotional opportunities, and I hope ArtHK can work more on this front. For the audience reach, ArtHK should consider how to expand the audience reach. Some citizens are not aware of the programs offered by ArtHK. Apart from posting more notices, how can you advertise these programs? Channels 31 and 32 have these very good programs. How can we let the public know? More compliments and criticisms. Secretary, thank you, Mr. Vincent Chang. Thank you for helping us with sports programs. We will actively study the points mentioned by member to see how we can let more members of the public know the programs aired by ArtHK in order to improve the service provided by ArtHK. We have a very fruitful discussion with very constructive comments. Agenda item number 5, any other business? There's no any other business. This is the end of the meeting day. Meeting adjourned. Thank you.